And good day, ladies and gentlemen from Washington. I am Robert Christian, your host, and this is the Robert Christian Show, looking at some of the news that we've been following. Brazilian police riots have fired water cannons and tear gas to disperse the anti-government protesters in central Sao Paulo today. While Congress, their Congress, opponents of the president have started the clock ticking on impeachment proceedings against their own government. What do you all think of that noise? Water cannons, really? Hey folks, in today's first hour of the show, David Pisarra, he is an attorney at law, and his film, What About Men? We're going to be taking a look at domestic violence. And to say that women aren't the only victims in this is really an understatement. But we're going to be getting into that with David today, so stay tuned. And in hour two, here is the lifelong question. What could Americans lose by voting for the wrong candidate for the office of the presidency of the United States? Actually, quite a lot. So if you want to get the gist of it, you want to get into the meat of it, stay tuned and stick around. In other news headlines, we are following a suspicious package of mail containing white powder was sent to Eric Trump's New York City apartment, a Trump organization source told ABC News today. The preliminary field test indicated that the substance did not appear to be hazardous. According to the source, who was behind, or rather who was briefed in the matter. The New York City Police Department confirmed to the news station that it responded to a call at Eric Trump's apartment, the high-end residential building in Central Park South, but the department did not identify the recipient who it was as Donald Trump's 32-year-old son. For those of you that live in Southern California, I love Southern California. Great friends there. Santa Ana, California. The U.S. Justice Department has sued to block Tribune Publishing Company from buying the bankrupt Orange County Register and other Southern California newspapers, arguing that the $56 million sale would limit the competition and harm its readers and advertisers in the region. I bring that up for a great reason, because there is a lot of money, as people know, in broadcasting, a lot of money in media. But how much is too much, and how big does a company have to be before it is too big? Austin, Texas, Michelle Obama, she showed off her vocal chops at the South by Southwest Music Festival, but drew a round of disappointed sighs when she told the crowd that she has no plans to run for president. Could you imagine? I had not heard about that. Let me get into this one just a little bit, folks. The Republican Party wants to snag the White House. If they do, this says, it should be put up, be up to a united front before Election Day in November. Now, listen to this. In the years where a political party was divided, like the Republican Party, like it is today, it was less likely to win the presidential election, according to a University of Georgia study. I love this. The study published in the Journal of Political Behavior found that a national party division had significant impact on the election outcomes. The researchers say that the Republican nominee could lose more than 3% of the votes in November if the party is not unified. For what it's worth, let's hope that the GOP remains stagnant and ununified. I'm Robert Christian. Stay tuned.
You're watching The Robert Christian Show. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
And a happy, how are you to everybody. You know what, I've done a lot of shows, as everybody knows, on the issue of politics in America. Because, you know, and I've said it before, and it made some people mad. It made them swoon. It made some people lose their false teeth in the wind. But here's the deal, folks. Because I had said a long time ago that the problem in America is that America as we know it, or as we knew it, was going to be divided. There would be an absolute divide. And guess what? We are seeing that rip happen right now. And if you ask me, ladies and gentlemen, it's sad. Here the Republican Party, the GOP, those morons in Congress and in the Senate, here they are with no check and balances. Where is it? They obviously, yes, there's a divide there. But when it comes to term limits, absolutely no. Not going to happen. When it comes to Citizens United, that's not going to happen. A no-go. And if you want a job, and I'm hey, this is a good question for you. A good deal. If you want a job, ladies and gentlemen, that you can vote for your own pay raise, become a congressman. We are with David Pisarra. Hello, David. It's great to have you back, by the way.
Thanks, Robert. It's great to be here.
And I am absolutely elated to have you back, because we've had you on before talking about what about men in domestic disputes, domestic violence. And one of the points that we had made the last time that you were on, David, was how often it actually occurs. Do you remember talking about that?
I do, and it's a very popular topic for me to discuss, because I'm one of those voices in the wind that's willing to say things that nobody else wants to hear, even though it's true. You know, nobody wants to hear that 60% or 70% of all domestic violence is actually mutual aggression. It's started by one or the other parties, and nobody can really tell which one. You know, nobody wants to talk about the fact that women are 70% of the time aggressors, because that's politically unpalatable. You know, Joe Biden was at the Oscars and getting all of his big kudos, and if you noticed, he slipped in "and boys" or "and men." But other than that, his entire speech was geared towards women. And he would have kept it that way if it hadn't been for Lady Gaga putting men on stage.
Well, David, what do you think about this? And you know, I really should, and I'm almost ashamed of myself, because we didn't go into it the last time that you were on. Let's for the sake of argument, look at state laws, because as I remember, California is one of these states, and so is Florida, that no matter what, if the police department is called to your home, to wherever, to come rescue you due to the fact of domestic violence or a call of domestic violence, somebody is going to go to jail.
That's pretty much the case.
Do you find, though, that most of these people, though, David, that end up going to jail are the men and not the women?
They are for a couple reasons. One, they're certainly biased among the police officers that men are the aggressors. Two, women play the victim's role just masterfully. You know, if you've ever seen a woman turn on the waterworks when she wants to accomplish something, it's truly astounding how a truly manipulative woman can be when they want to accomplish something. Three, the way in which the police are trained to handle these situations is such that it's easier for them to take the man into custody because he's more gullible. He's not looking at this as a situation where he needs to be in opposition to his female partner. He's still thinking of them as a family unit, and she's not. So one of the things that happens is, you know, if a man is on his front yard and he has had a drink, maybe he's had a beer, it's a Sunday afternoon, and she's called the police on him, if the police don't technically have grounds to arrest him, what they will do is they will say from the street, "Come over here, I want to talk to you." Now he's on public property, now he's drunk in public, and he will be arrested for drunk in public. So they have their ways of making sure things happen when they want to make things happen.
Why do you think that women play off on it?
Is they're starting to look at the situation and recognize that it's usually a mutual aggression, and they'll try and either take both parties in, or they'll try and make the whole thing go away. they'll say to him, why don't you go spend the night in a hotel and just leave? And because if there are children involved, they don't want to take both parents into jail because then the kids have to go on the foster care system.
And but what if both parents, though, were the guilty party? Both of them were guilty of the same thing.
The police will still – sometimes they will take both parties in, but they will still oftentimes try and make it – leave her in the house and make him go sleep in his car or get a hotel room and cool off for the night is what they'll call it.
Right. You know, well, you know,
say, rather than take both of you in, why don't you go away and then neither of you will go?
You know, I have been watching a lot of these old cops shows, and I love watching these cop shows, some of the older ones, especially, well, you know, the ones out of Florida. Love them. I think they're great. But it's interesting to sit and go through some of these old shows and see how that they dealt with people in domestic violence. And too often, it is the men that, you know, they're held accountable if they are the guilty party or not. So, folks, it takes a lawyer like David Pisarra to stand up to the plate and go to bat for these men. But, folks, that is just a part of what David is about. David, before we actually get into the meat of today's show, tell us a secret.
Well, I don't really have too many secrets. You know, the problem of living a public life, you know, being a writing column in the paper and doing videos and podcasts, is, you know, all the really dirty, nasty stuff I don't get to do because I'm so worried that it's going to get out. So my life is pretty vanilla. You know, I think probably the closest thing to a secret would be my favorite foods, and that would be any kind of like berry pie. You know, if you got like a huckleberry pie, I will fly across the country for a good huckleberry pie.
Really? You like that? Really?
It's one of my favorite flavors. And you don't get it very often down here. I know in the Northwest it's more common, but down here it's a hard thing to come by.
What about, you know, a long time ago, my mother, bless her heart, here she was going through nursing school, and she just bought groceries, and she bought 6 or 8 of these chocolate cream pies, you know, the frozen ones. Anyway, into the thing they went. They weren't there very long because I ate one of them, a whole pie. And you know what? I liked it so much. It was absolutely to die for when it was about half frozen. I loved it. Needless to say, when it was all done, well, none of the pies existed thereafter. I ate all of them. And she is yet to let me live that down. So, David, that's cool that you like... what about Mexican food? L.A. is famous for its food. What about Mexican food?
Mexican food is really amazing. You know, we are lucky in that we have some amazing chefs here. And it's funny because I spend usually the month of December down in Mexico. And I can't wait to come back to L.A. for, like, really good Mexican food. Yeah. But when it comes to my favorite, a really good mole with lots of strong dark chocolate flavor over like chicken and rice is one of my favorite things.
There is a hole in the wall, or at least many years ago, David will know where I'm talking about, and some other people may have just heard about it. But there was a really good hole in the wall there on Avera Street. They're downtown or close to downtown. That's one of the oldest streets in Los Angeles is Avera. The first time that I went to L.A., I remember going to that place, and I mean they had some of the best Mexican food I could ever want to eat. A little hole in the wall. I mean, hey, you know, buy local or buy local.
Still there. I can't remember the name of it, but it's still there.
Well, isn't after all those years, gee whiz. You know, but hey, folks, if you want good authentic food, some of the best authentic Mexican food that I ever had, though, David, I've got to say, was in Mexico. It was there in just south of Tijuana many years ago.
You know, it's pretty funny because I'm a pretty hearty soul, and I like eating at those roadside stands as you're just driving down the street in Mexico. And I'll agree with you. I mean, I've had some of the most flavorful, amazing things there. And people always look at me like, are you crazy? What are you doing eating at one of those? You're going to get sick and die. And I'm like, you know, the truth is, all the times I've been going there, I've never once gotten sick at a roadside stand. Now, some of the restaurants that I've eaten at, those I've gotten sick at.
You know, absolutely. You got to watch where you're eating. You do. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. There's one fast food chain that we would frequent years ago. We haven't been back there in at least 18 years because we ended up getting food poisoning as a result of eating there. So I'm not going to eat there anymore. I am so done with that. Okay, David, what's your favorite kind of music, and then we'll talk movies.
I'm kind of a wackadoodle dude. I'm not very good on music. I describe myself as Helen Keller when it comes to music. But generally when I'm working, I have sort of either classical or an ambient world beat music going in the background. It's just enough to like keep it going, but I don't have to pay too much attention to it.
You know, Gene Simmons, you may remember him from Kiss. Well, it just came out in the news yesterday that he thinks that it is time for rap. Speaking of music, it's time for rap to die. Do you agree with it?
I don't really know what rap is, so sure.
I mean, to me, it's atrocious. I don't know. It's just my thing. I never did like it, but yeah, he says, hey, it's time for rap to die. All right, let's get into movies, David. The documentary What About Men? What is the ultimate goal that you have in mind concerning that documentary?
Well, let me start with saying that the documentary is called What About the Men? Exploring the hidden side of domestic violence. And what we're doing is we're looking at men who have been victimized in heterosexual relationships and what has driven them into and kept them in bad relationships, and the factors that go to causing the abuse. What does abuse really mean? So what we're trying to do is shine a light on the entire topic, because what I want to do is explain to men in language that they will understand and with examples that they can be abused and not even know it. Because the biggest problem we run up against when we're representing men is that they don't see bad behavior as being abusive. Mm-hmm. I had a client in my office not too long ago, and I said, so was there any abuse in your relationship? He said, no, not really. I mean, you know, she'd hit me over the head with a hair dryer once a week, but that wasn't really bad. And I'm like, dude, seriously. It doesn't get a whole lot clearer than that, because the hairdryer will soon enough become the butcher knife, and then we're going to be reading about you in the back page of the murder section.
Right.
You know, and they just don't see it. So what I'm trying to do is raise awareness among men of what constitutes abuse before it gets to the point where things boil over and everybody gets hurt. You know, if they can start seeing that there's precursor behavior that will become a trigger that will eventually light them to the point where they're hitting the wall or maybe hitting their spouse. And if we can stop that, we're stopping abuse against women. We're stopping the cycle of the children seeing men abusing women. And we can maybe even get the women to stop their abuse if they start recognizing that their behavior is abusive. So that's the main goal of the movie, is education and awareness.
Well, David, let me ask you this of you, and it may be on a personal note, perhaps, but how directly, because you're very passionate about it, and I enjoy the passion, absolutely, but too often, when somebody has a passion like yours, like my own in media, I mean, I guess that's what it is, but somehow or another, in your life, though, something triggered you. Something pulled that trigger. And sure. For you, David, made you think, you know what? If I can't stand it for these people, nobody will. So I ask you, have you dealt personally with domestic violence in your own life, in your family's life? And is that really the root cause of you exploring what you're now doing now and changing people's lives?
The short answer is yes. I come from a family where there was lots of domestic violence. There was lots of alcoholism. You know, Friday night fights in my family were in the living room. They weren't on the television. So when I was 5 or 6, I have a very clear memory of my mother taking one of those 8 or 10 inch kitchen knives and showing me how to knife fight. And that when you're fighting with somebody, you put it blade side up. So when they go to knock it down, they cut themselves. That's the household I grew up in. My mother was as abusive to my father as he was to her, but they were each in different ways. So he might have been physical, where she would be cutting with her words. I say my mother could fillet you like a plate of lox with her words. And she was a wonderful person, and I love my mother dearly. This is not that I hate my mother, but I recognize that her behavior led to abusive behavior towards my father that escalated, and eventually their situation, their alcoholism, it explodes. Had we been able to recognize that her behavior was abusive, maybe we would have been able to shunt that off into a better direction so that nobody actually got damaged. So that's sort of my background. And then when you factor in, now I become a lawyer and I want to fight the good fight, I'm going into court, I'm representing men, I'm representing women, and what I'm seeing is the women are winning easily and the men keep getting shredded. Well, being a gay man in America, I'm kind of always going to root for the underdog because I've been the underdog for a long time. So now I'm in the situation where, okay, I'm a gay lawyer who's fighting for primarily heterosexual men to get father's rights and to defend themselves against false domestic violence cases. Mm-hmm. There's a movie in there somewhere, I'm sure. I just haven't figured it out yet.
You know,
in terms of my own story.
I mean, David, I've talked about on live shows periodically over the years, you know, for me, what became a just something fun for me to do, which, well, I used to take radios apart, tear them apart, old tube type radios, and I'd put them back together, and they would actually that work. But I wanted to know what made them work, and then I discovered, hey, I want to be that little guy on the radio. Okay, well, those days have come and gone. But for me, it's like media chose me, broadcasting chose me, and not so much that I chose it as a career. I mean, I would have to be brain dead if it did, but it chose me. But I mean, I've had a judge, an actual sitting judge, tell me, hey, you know what, Robert, you should have been an attorney. I've had other people say, why didn't you go become a doctor? I've got doctors and nurses in my family. But that wasn't my knack. And so, David, putting this line of question into perspective, your past has given you a knack. It's given you a vision to push forward. But in your own words, how has your past helped somebody else in their present life to push forward?
Well, in many ways, when I'm representing a father going into court who's facing supervised visitation, loss of his children, any of those situations, I draw on my experience of how do you get through tough times. And I share those with him, and that gets him through the rough patch. And then there's the actual professional work I do, where I go in and I expose the lie, and I get the judge to see that this is nothing but a ploy by mom to get more time with the kids, because that translates into money. And that's what a lot of times this really all boils down to. It's money, it's child support. It's not that he's a bad dad. It's not that he's abusive. It's not that she's really afraid of him. It's that she wants more custodial time, because custodial time translates into higher support awards.
You know, David, you're an amazing man, because you have turned what was so bad and so negative in your life into something so powerful. Maybe you have an idea, but I'm here to tell you, this is your life. This is what you've done. And on behalf of men and women that have suffered as a direct result of domestic violence, thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Hey, folks, we're going to be back right after our short break with David Pisarra, and we're going to get into some juice about his movie. If you haven't heard about his movie, well, get ready, because you probably will. David, he is an up-and-coming director, I guess, producer?
Producer-director.
There he And so we're going to be talking about his movie, what he's done so far on it, and when to expect it, of course, out in the theaters. And kind of what is the scope of this? Folks, you know, anytime that you go and you're going to do this, right? You're going to do a movie. Granted, you know, there takes an awful lot of work behind it. There absolutely does. Folks, hey, we're going to take us our short break. Here we go. We'll be right back with more of The Robert Christian Show up next. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are back with the Robert Christian Show, and hello wherever that you are around the world. And you know what? Guess what? For those of you, thank you, Mr. Band Director. For those of you that would like to know, we have three platforms for the show that we air on, and. All of them, you can access them on any mobile. This is so awesome. This is technology. You can you can access all of them from your car, from your cruise ship, from your yacht, from your dinghy on the back of a yacht. I mean, it's amazing. So we have we've got the goods, I think, on this, right? So, folks, we're doing the best that we can with what we have. You betcha. And, of course, we are. David, get this. We have had requests for us to get a hold of the fine folks over at NPR Radio for them to start airing, a big NPR for them to start airing the shows. So, who knows? We might get that going. I have not a clue. You know, that's one of them, but there's, I think, three of them that are in line waiting, or we're waiting on responses back from them, so you never know what can happen, right?
Yeah.
So, David, with the movie, the documentary, what stage in this are you at presently?
Well, we started production, and the production lasted through a trailer. We got the trailer finished. The trailer was used to do a very small crowdfunding campaign. We raised $5,300. Originally wanted $5,000, so we exceeded our goals. And the purpose for the crowdfunding campaign was twofold. One, it was for me to have the experience of going out to the public and saying, "Can you help me?" And I was amazed at the level of support that I got from my friends and family and people that I never even met before who saw my post on Facebook and Twitter, and, you know, I would send things out, little blurbs about the movie or about the trailer or about what's going on in the world of domestic violence. And the support was astounding to me, because literally the first $500 that came in was from people that I didn't even know, which I thought was just amazing to me. That's the world we live in. So that was the last part of 2015. We hit the holidays and sort of everything shut down over the holidays. We're just now gearing back up to start interviewing our experts and go out after corporate funding. Because once we've done our crowdfunding, now we have a basis to go to Gillette and Adidas and Nike and Under Armour and say, you know, here's an issue that of domestic violence that needs support. And you guys have given a lot of money to women's causes, whether it's breast cancer, whether it's ending domestic violence for women. And now we need to do something for the boys because they're your primary customer. You know, if you're Gillette and you give $10 million to the Susan G. Komen Foundation, why haven't you given $500,000 to support this movie?
I agree.
And why haven't you, Under Armour, supported men when it comes to domestic violence as victims when you're more than willing to go after the Breast Cancer Foundation money? So that's sort of where we are. We're swinging back into production, and as we go and get more money from corporate America, we're going to swing further into production.
You know, I think it's the storyline, it is so real. It is so realistic. And, you know, David, I can completely understand where you are and your feelings behind it and why it is so important. I mean, look, my own childhood was anything but a bed of roses. There was a lot of abuse. And I wrote several years ago my autobiography, my life story. And, you know, I wrote it with the reader in mind, but trying to paraphrase, trying to go back through some of the ill tempers that I grew up with in the family environment. And, you know, if that was what family is supposed to be like, I decided back then I didn't want it.
Right.
Too much abuse. And, you know, so it brings me to this point, David. As being a survivor of domestic violence, domestic abuse in the home, that much I share with you, David. But my question now is, what happens to the children?
Well, the children become the victims or the abusers in the future, and that's why we need to put an end to the topic. That's why I'm trying to stop the cycle, you know, because so often when a boy grows up in an abusive household and he sees mom beating up on dad, that creates a sense of rage in that child that will play itself out later down the line. You know, we know that this can lead to abuse on his own part, abuse of drugs and alcohol. It can lead to abusive relationships where he's going to make bad choices in terms of who he gets in a relationship with. And it can lead to abuse in terms of how he plays that out with other men. Because that sense of rage will not necessarily be directed at the proper person. You know, oftentimes these things come out sideways and you get mad at the people around as opposed to the one that you're really supposed to get mad at. And so by breaking the cycle, I'm hoping that we can make those children's lives that much better. And if we can make parents aware that they're abusive to their spouses, maybe they will stop that behavior and their children won't see it.
Well, we have heard, I guess, maybe the tip of the iceberg, David, but I wonder what percentage of domestic violence victims actually lose their life because of it.
That would be an interesting number to try and suss out. It's a hard one because so often when we have intimate partner violence, the murders are considered homicides, and it doesn't get classified as a domestic violence issue. So even though it should be, because really on the spectrum of domestic violence, it's the terminal point over here of death. You know, that's the Travis Alexander who got murdered by Jody Arias. Nobody wants to think about that as domestic violence. It's just crazy woman attacks and kills her boyfriend. It's just like when OJ killed Nicole Brown Simpson, but everybody knows that that's domestic violence because that's what everybody heard. Nobody talks about it when a man is a victim. So sussing those numbers out is going to be kind of complicated because of the way they're recorded. You know, it's much like the way the FBI and the federal government has classified rape and sexual assault and made to penetrate. Now, rape is a man attacking a woman. sexual assault is either a man or a woman being sexually harassing with the other, and made to penetrate is when a woman rapes a man. But that's not considered rape. That's considered made to penetrate. It's a separate category of sexual assault. So what the government has done is they're breaking things out in such a way that it's really hard to add the numbers back and come up with a true number.
But it's not uncommon, though. Well, although it should be uncommon, but it's not necessarily that uncommon then for someone that is a domestic violence, I can't say survivor, but victim of it, to die. It happens.
It does happen, and it happens quite often. When they add, say, reports of, a woman dies every 3 hours or whatever the number is, that's a domestic violence murder. But it's also, that same thing happens with men who are victims. It's not classified as domestic violence. It's a lover's quarrel because, she was premenstrual, got mad, stabbed him 43 times. Oops, she slipped. And then she's going to get off because she's going to get up there and say, he was mean and abusive to me, and then I had to do it, and I was scared that I was going to get killed, and now it's self-defense.
Now, David, in Southern California, and anybody who has been watching the news lately, this made the news. O.J. Simpson back in the news again with the issue with Nicole. Now, David, I know that you weren't privy to that, the court findings and the hearings on that so much, but as an attorney and as somebody that lives in Southern California, I ask you this. Do you think that was a good parallel? Would you consider that just a murder that had happened, or would you consider that domestic violence that turned even worse?
No, I think it was absolutely domestic violence. I think it was the terminal point of domestic violence. And that's so often the case with these relationships, is they're going to reach a terminal point, and it ends with somebody being dead. And that's unfortunate. And that's one of the reasons why the movie is so crucial, because it could just as easily have been the man that got murdered. It happens all the time. We just don't call it domestic violence.
But why not?
Because domestic violence has been co-opted by the feminist lobby, because there's a lot of money in it. There's a lot of money in domestic violence shelters. There's a lot of money that Joe Biden, our vice president, has pushed through in the Violence Against Women Act. There's a lot of money in domestic violence because if you are a victim of domestic violence, you get custody of the children, you get custody of the house, which means that he's going to have to pay child support and alimony in much greater dollar amounts. So there's money involved. Whenever you look at, it's my opinion that whenever you look at any societal issue, follow the money. And that's always what the answer is. There will always be a pot of gold somewhere. If there's legislation, somebody is getting paid off for it, and the question is who. So I don't care how often they look at it and they say, we have all these victims and this is the issue. Yes, there are victims. Yes, we need to deal with it. But are you dealing with it fairly, or are you dealing with it to feather your own nest?
Well, who would actually stand in the way, David, when you're looking at Congress or the U.S. Senate, for that matter? What companies or who would actually stand in the way and say that domestic violence doesn't exist, and men, they're the perpetrators of this 100%?
They're not going to say domestic violence doesn't exist. What they're going to say is women are overwhelmingly the victims of domestic violence perpetrated by men. Men are a minuscule percentage of the victims. Therefore, we don't need to fund it. And who's behind that? Let's start with the National Organization for Women. Let's start with the National Network to End Domestic Violence. Let's start with 1 in 6, Joyful Heart. These are all organizations and nonprofits that generate a large amount of money through government grants, through donations, that support their position that women are primarily the victims of domestic violence, therefore we need to deal with them and we don't need to deal with men. They can take care of themselves.
But that's not, obviously that's not the case.
It's not even close to the case. Women are overwhelmingly the aggressors in these relationships.
Now, David, comes page two. Ding! Here's page two. Folks,
yes, hey,
if you want a page count, now we're on page two. David, you know, a great question, a powerful one. And I know your answer is going to be spot on. It always is. But it's not going to even be the tip of the iceberg. But when you're dealing with domestic violence, a lot of times, the majority of the time, 90% or maybe more of the time, that Americans' appetite of understanding, I'll have to phrase it like that, for domestic violence is a heterosexual event. That, oh no, it never happens in the gay community or the lesbian community or the transsexual community. It just doesn't happen. Are they right or wrong?
Well, they're completely wrong. You know, because it certainly happens in the gay community, in the trans community, in the lesbian community. It happens in the bisexual community, because all of these things have one thing in common. They're all humans involved. And humans cause domestic violence.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is we don't want to look at it and say it's a human problem. We're still trying to figure it out and blame, oh, the boys are the problem. Oh, the girls are the problem. No, everybody is the problem. We need to talk about it differently. We need to talk about it in a way of what are the causes of it? Why do people react the way they do? Why do they not see the red flags and stop the red flags and throw up the white flags? Yeah. Statistically, though, if you look at it, in the gay community, to males, there is domestic violence, certainly. And it's going to be physical. It's also going to be less common than what you see between two lesbians. Why is that? Because lesbians both feel empowered to be very aggressive, and then when they're fighting each other, they're both going to be very aggressive. If I'm in a relationship with a man, I'm 5'5 and 190-ish right now. If I'm dating somebody who's 6'4 and 260, I'm going to be very careful about hitting him, as is he. Because I know that I am poking a tiger. I know that when I get him angry enough, he's going to swing back at me. There's that level of deterrence that happens. We don't see that level of deterrence with women because they don't have to deal with it. Because they feel entitled. Why? Because you never hit a woman. And that thread has run through to the point where even when women are in relationships with each other, they don't see how that's affecting them, that it actually is affecting them in a view that they are entitled to hit somebody because they're not going to get hit back.
Well, David, I tell you what, when we come back from our the final break for this first hour of today's live show, I want to go into something, a brand new deal. So I guess we'll call this another paragraph. But definitely,
page three. Run page three.
Say again.
Page three?
Yeah, page three. But this is, hey, we're on page three. Well, in England, that would mean something else. That's kind of like the naughty naughty. But when we come back, David, I want to talk about perhaps the percentage of people that are domestic violence survivors and or perpetrators who suffer from mental illness. And does that, what kind of an impact does that actually have on the relationship and on the actual violent attacks? Is it a mental health issue? Should it be addressed as that? Folks, we're going to be right back. We're blowing the lid. I got to tell you, we are blowing the lid off this with David. Love David. You know what, folks? Of anybody that I love to have on the show that always leaves everybody on the edge of their seat like one more inch and clunk, you're going to fall on the floor. It's David. I love it. All right, folks, we're going to be right back. Don't go too far. Oh, yeah, okay, wrong slate. I know. Wow. All right, folks, we shall return momentarily. And live from Washington, the Robert Christian Show. Our special guest, David Pisarra. He's our featured guest. Next week, let me remind everybody, next week, A&E's hit series, Storage Wars. Dan Dotson, the fast-talking auctioneer, is going to be back on. Can you all auctioneer? Is that what it is? Can you actually do that? Hey, I've tried. And I've made him laugh. Been there, done that. Next, but he's next week. Don't forget. Pastor Cynthia Andrews Looper on her new book that is actually out now on Amazon.com. Two Pews from Crazy. Lovely. Marilyn Redmond coming back on. Also, Mike Nagoda. Hello, Mike. Love you, guy. We're going to have you. He's a great musician. Kathy is coming on, Kathy. And, hey, she has some things. You know what? It's amazing, folks. The live shows, we are booked up right now about 6 months in advance. And we have been inundated with requests, right, for people to come on. I think it's great. I really do. And I want it to be an honor to them. I want everybody to that we interview, that we have on, to feel at home, at ease, at peace, and feel like, hey, their message can get out there. And it is. That's great. I'm really faced with a dilemma. And here it is. The dilemma is, should we go into two shows weekly or should we just stay at one show a week? What's the deal? Because we were Monday through Friday at one time. So, having said that, I don't know, but folks, be the first to know. Stay tuned in. We are back with David. Hello, David.
Hey, Robert.
So, let's visit just for a bit about mental illness when it comes to domestic violence. Do you find that works together or not?
Oh, absolutely. There's definitely a tie-in of mental illness because that's such a broad category. You know, when we're talking about mental health, we've got everything from your standard neuroses, anxiety type people, or just a little bit quirky, through to narcissist, bipolars, borderline personalities. And your borderline personalities are bumping right up against your psychotics in many cases. You know, and then we've got your schizophrenics. Now, schizophrenics, you're not going to really come across so much in domestic violence in reality because they're not going to be in relationships generally. What we're talking about primarily are narcissists and borderline personality disorders are what we generally see when it comes to domestic violence cases. And that sort of breaks down in broad strokes. Men tend to be more narcissistic. Women tend to be more borderline. At the end of the day, what it really is a very slight difference in definition. But both of those at the end of the day are all about how are you perceiving me, and then I'm going to change the way I treat you so that you change the way you perceive me. And that leads to a lot of anger and frustration because if I can't change you, and we know how likely that is, I'm going to get angry. and I'm going to get frustrated, and then I want to control you. And then when that doesn't work, things bubble up, and they blow up, and they explode into domestic violence.
So do you, as far as mental health is concerned, would you perhaps say that there could be a temporary a chemical imbalance in people's body, in their head, when domestic violence actually happens? Or is this too often? Would you find that this is meaningful? It was sought after. It was meant to be. It was designed. It was pre-orchestrated, more or less.
There certainly can be those transitory chemical imbalances. You know, in that, to be brutally honest, you know, that starts with I went out and had a couple beers and got drunk. You know, that's a chemical imbalance. There's transitory depression, whether it's postpartum, whether it's a man hitting mid-50s, and the depression in a man will generally manifest itself in anger. Oftentimes, once we get really depressed, then we start getting angry because people are trying to tell us, well, pull out of it, snap out of it, smile, do this, and then, so you're now trying to control me in a relationship, that can manifest as anger. You know, if you're talking about more permanent, organic things like borderline personality, narcissist, that's not transitory. So those are things that you're going to see in a relationship. Generally, they're going to be revealed after a period of time in the relationship, because those people who have those disorders, not consciously, but sort of unconsciously, know that if they reveal too much too soon, the red flags will go up, and people won't get in the relationship with them. So they start off by being really sweet and nice and kind, and before you know it, you're the devil incarnate who can't do anything right. So it's sort of a transitory, a developmental stage that people go through when you're dealing with some organic problems.
Well, David, you've hit on quite a lot of things on this show that you did not we didn't get a chance to hit on the last time that you were on a show. But listen, David, we're down to the last couple of minutes before the top of the hour. So when people want to donate to your work, to your movie, the documentary, and or where can they get information about it? Where would you send them?
They can go to whataboutthemen.com is our primary website, and you can see the trailer on there. And the trailer's a really great exposition of what this issue is all about. It starts with three men telling their stories, and they're three very diverse men. We have a large African-American man who's all tattooed and got piercings, and the least likely guy when you look at him to think like he could ever be in an abusive relationship and be the victim. We have a standard all-American guy who you're listening to, and he's explaining what happened in his relationship. And then we have a former police officer. And a former police officer explains what he went through, knowing about it from both sides of the table. And then we've got experts coming in to explain what's happening to the men. And I think that, you know, for the 3 minutes that it's going to take for somebody to watch the trailer on the website, whataboutthemen.com, you're going to learn something about the movie and about the topic. And that's kind of a really great flavor of where we're going with the movie. Right now, we're not really in a fundraising stage, although we will take donations. It is tax deductible. It goes to an organization called Stop Abuse for Everyone. They're our fiscal sponsor. And as a consequence of that, anything you donate does become fully tax deductible. So if you want to slip us a quick $50 or $100, we'll definitely take it, because we've got a lot of travel coming up as we're ramping up interviewing experts in Pennsylvania, Washington, down in San Diego. We're trying to plan out a trip to England to see Erin Pitsey, who's sort of the godmother of domestic violence. And there's a ton of things happening down in Australia that I'd love to be able to explore. And if we do another crowdfunding campaign, I'm sure I'll be back. So.
Well, awesome. Well, David, we'd love to have you back as you start getting things ramped up to start the remainder, I'll put it that way, of the filming. I think it'll be great to touch base with you again because I hold this this matter very serious and very deep to my heart and to my the fiber of my being. And David, I'm proud. I'm honored to know you and to know that that you are actually standing up and doing something about it.
Well, thank you, Robert. It's an honor to be here, and it's an honor to do the work.
And so, folks, it is whataboutthemen.com, yes?
Yep.
And people can donate there on through the website.
Fantastic.
Awesome. Well, David, thanks so very much once again, dear friend, for coming back on and talking about this. And, hey, as soon as I can, I will give you the link for the interview, and you can share it and share it alike. That'd be great. All right, David. Well, listen, I will let you go for the time being.
Have a good weekend, sir. Take care.
You too, David. All right, folks, David Pisarra with What About the Men. Fantastic young man. He really is. He has an awful lot, of course, to talk about. And his movie, fantastic. Wow. All right, folks, we are going to take a short break. When we come back, ladies and gentlemen, after the top of the hour, oh, my goodness gracious, we are going to dive into the issue of the Republican Party. Can you imagine that? And, well, maybe the Democratic Party. And ask the question, hey, what do you think about? And really, what can America stand to lose if we vote for the wrong candidate? RobertChristianShow.com, the only address you need. And we will be right back. Don't go away. Live from Washington, the Robert Christian Show will return in 1 minute. Stick around.